Hi, I'm Dr. Sridhar. In this video, we'll quickly review the management of infants born to women with hepatitis B virus, and this is the CDC guideline basically. So we should be aware of why it's very important to prevent perinatal hepatitis B transmission. Of course, we know that hepatitis B is a relatively serious infection, but when they acquire it in the perinatal period, even though the babies are asymptomatic, most infants, about 90% who are infected with hepatitis B, will develop chronic infection, and 25% of these will die prematurely from cancer or cirrhosis. Perinatal transmission is preventable, and that's why it's very important that we look for it, and maternal hepatitis B serum should be reviewed before every delivery, and by any chance, if she doesn't have the reports, we should do it soon after delivery. So the perinatal transmission can be prevented by screening during every pregnancy. If the mother is HBsAg positive, they should receive HBIg and a dose of single antigen hepatitis B vaccine less than or equal to 12 hours of birth. So this is very important, critical to do it at the earliest possible, and both are given at different sites at the same time. And this should be followed by a complete series of hepatitis B vaccine, which is up to 94% effective in preventing perinatal transmission. And because there is a 6% risk, that is why we need to monitor the serology at 9 to 12 months. If the hepatitis B immunoglobulin is missed, for example, we don't have the result of the hepatitis B in the mother and we are doing the test and it takes 24 hours or so, you can still give the immunoglobulin and vaccine within 7 days, but beyond 7 days immunoglobulin doesn't seem to benefit. So it's very critical that we document whatever is discussed in this regard, and if parents don't want the test to be done, we should document it. The risk is very high for them. So simple explanation for the management: more than or equal to 2 kilos and a separate chart for less than 2 kilos. Even if the baby is more than 2 kilos, the dosage regimen is the same. The dose of immunoglobulin that you use will depend on the product you use, and they are given at two different sites and both thighs, for example. And this, if the single antigen is given at birth, obviously you don't give the combination at birth. And then if you're following up a series with the single antigen, you give one second dose between 1 and 2 months and the third dose at 6 months. So there should be at least 6 months between the first and the third dose. If you have a combination dose vaccine schedule, like in India or any other country, in UAE, for example, we follow 2, 4, and 6 months. So you'd follow that schedule. So the baby ultimately receives 4 doses, with the third dose, the last dose, being received 6 months after the first dose, then it would meet the requirement. In a baby who is less than 2 kilos, the only difference is that if they are getting a standalone vaccine, you would get the additional dose. So you get 1, 2, 3, and 4. So the 1 month dose becomes mandatory, and then you give another dose between 2 and 3 months. So it's basically first dose is ignored, and then you're repeating. And because if they are getting by the vaccine schedule, the combination vaccine at 2, 4, and 6 months, they would be getting 3 more doses anyway. So basically the efficacy of the vaccine is less if they are under 2 kilos, and you would consider a 4-dose regime in these babies. The post-vaccination serologic test is recommended around 9 to 12 months. And if the last dose is delayed for any reason, at least 2 months after the last dose. So the options from that testing, if they are immune, you would have the HBsAg negative, anti-HBs positive, and the antibody level would be more than 10. In these cases, no further follow-up would be needed. If they are still susceptible, the HBsAg is negative, but anti-HBs is negative, antibody level is less than 10. So you may need additional vaccine in some situations, especially if you are in a high-risk category later on. Unfortunately, if the baby does get infected, then the HBsAg would be positive in this case, and anti-HBs would be negative, as the immunity may not develop enough to clear the virus. If you measure the test, within the first 18 days of life, the test may be positive. And if you measure very late, obviously the anti-HBs titers may drop below less than 10, and then you would end up doing more for them unnecessarily. So this testing is indicated for infants and children born to women with hepatitis B infection. As I said, there is a 6% risk despite the early protection measures, so you still need to test it. The serologic testing confirms whether the child has developed immunity or has been infected with the hepatitis B virus. And this screening should include hepatitis B surface antigen and hepatitis B surface antibody only. So anti-HBC should not be done. And it should be timed between 9 to 12 months of age or 1 to 2 months after the vaccine series completion if the series is delayed for any reason. There should be a minimum of 6 months, but it can be a longer interval if there is a delay. And we should test for hepatitis. We should not do tests for hepatitis B core antigen because these may reflect the maternal antibodies and it can persist in the baby's system till 24 months of age. And it's better not to perform too early or too late, as I mentioned earlier. So I hope this short video is useful.